See you next week. Okay. You're next.
No, Mendo, please. No. What behind you, Mendo?
What? You thought I wouldn't be back.
It's Mike.
You thought you'd captured me forever.
Well, where'd you get my katana? Is that from my collection? Is that the one I imported from Japan?
Oh, wow.
My gun. Now you're Ben Mendelsohn.
Wow. Oh my gosh.
Oh. Tell Eric about her.
Oh no. Dude, that was savage. He deserved to die. He was a weeaboo. He had a katana collection.
All right, now we should probably get rid of the body before we do the proper episode.
All right, probably.
Did you guys already do an episode?
No.
Okay.
So, he was about to kill me.
So we're up to issue 52, 53?
Yeah, pretty much. Did you read it?
Nope. So we should skip to the next two.
Oh, 50, okay.
53. Wait, what is it? You'd know.
53 and 54.
Let's do those ones.
Okay.
Hello and welcome to this week's episode of the Peter Palmer Podcast, where we attempt to read every issue of The Amazing Spider-Man week by week, so you can be a Spider-Man expert, I guess.
Yeah, well, define expert, though.
I mean, if you consider us Spider-Man experts, but, you know, we don't know that
Maybe
much.
Maybe we're just deranged.
Yeah. I skipped last week, right? Mendo took my place. I'm a bit out of whack.
Yeah.
He did pretty well, though, didn't he?
Considering, yeah.
How'd he get my voice on point? I mean, do you reckon he has, like, one of those Mission Impossible masks?
Maybe. I don't know. I had my blindfold on for the whole episode.
Physically, we're very different, so I don't know how he got away with that.
Well, I couldn't actually see who I was with that week because I had a blindfold on because I was trying the Bird Box Challenge.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That makes sense why I listened to last week's episode and you started... Talking about Christopher Walken.
Yeah.
So anyways. What did you watch this week? What did you read?
I guess. Read the Communist Manifesto. No, I didn't. I don't know why I said that. I read the back of a shampoo bottle. Okay, I'm just playing with y'all.
What?
Did I talk about the new Umbrella Academy last week?
Yeah.
Okay, I already said that. Okay. I started reading. No, okay, don't worry. I want to talk about novels.
Shazam.
Oh, yeah, we watched Shazam. Yeah.
Because we watched it recently.
Why did I stumble?
Are we doing a review of that or are we just going to talk about it on this?
Let's just talk about it.
All right. So, Shazam. We had high hopes for this movie. What? Are you trying to knock out your teeth?
I want to get them to guess what that noise is.
If you can successfully guess what she is tapping on her teeth right now, then you get a no prize.
Yeah, no prize.
Yeah.
Okay.
In Stanley tradition.
Yeah, Stanley tradition, no prize. We will actually mail you a no prize. We're not even kidding.
If you can handle that.
I'll do it, yeah.
I mean, you send letters for real estate, don't you? Or something?
Don't reveal my second job.
You send letters from Santa to the North Pole.
From Santa to the North Pole.
From Santa with love.
Okay.
Anyway, Shazam, did you like it? I really liked Shazam.
Yeah. It was good. Even though I had obviously there were some parts of it that were not parts, but there were some things about that I was couldn't help but laugh at, but probably not in the way the film intended. Like the bad guy looks like Sans Undertale. He literally looks like Sans Undertale, and every time he faced the screen and ascended, floated, I was like, it was really funny.
Which I didn't think of, but I thought he was a good villain.
Yeah.
It's scary. There's one bit that was, it's not as good as the hospital scene from Spider-Man 2, but it had those vibes where it's like, suddenly like, what the hell? Everything's just like, people are dying and being slammed against windows.
He literally like 9/11 someone.
I guess that's kind of spoilers, but I'm not saying like really. And you didn't like the design of his creatures, the seven deadly sins?
No, because I feel like in my mind, I would have like taken way more creative liberty and made them like so much. I don't know. Maybe that's like something people don't like, but in my eyes, when you have something as like cool to play, it was like the seven deadly sins. I would have made them like so, whoa, like scary. But they were scary, but okay, I understand. I don't know. I just feel like you could have been, they all were the same color. I think that's why it annoyed me.
Oh, because they're statues.
I know, yeah.
They remind me of Ghostbusters. That's why I liked it. The demons from Ghostbusters. not the one with the whammon in it. The original one with the dudes. You know?
Liam Hemsworth.
I forget what those demons were called.
I haven't seen Ghostbusters Sigourney Weaver's in 12
like
years.
Demon dogs, you know?
Yeah. I haven't seen it in 12 years, so...
Well, you could have made Boyhood 2 in that time, dude. What are you doing? So you just waited.
I just waited. Wasting my life.
We didn't say much about Shazam. I think
watch it. It's good.
It is good. It had early 2000s superhero movie
vibes.
Yes,
I love that.
Specifically for me, it gave me Sky High vibes a little bit, especially the third act a little.
Yeah.
I like that it was set around Christmas time.
Yeah, that
I wish
cool.
it had more Christmas music.
Yeah, it didn't have...
Like, I was expecting at least in the third act, because it's, like, at a carnival, they'd have Christmas music.
When they showed up at the carnival, I thought he would have PTSD.
Well...
I thought that's why it was at a carnival.
Yeah, well, I liked that, though, because I was, like... There's a point in the movie where I was, like, oh, shit, the third act's going to be at a carnival.
Because
it would round off the movie. Mm. I'm, like, yeah. And there's that nice little moment where... Like, this isn't really a spoiler, but he sees, like, the dad and a daughter... And he gives her the tiger because he never got that when he was a kiddo.
Yeah.
He says something nice. I'm like, that
he
was
says,
nice.
He says, hold on to it real tight. You'll be all right. Just think twice.
It was
I'm
good.
All
it had a good right. emotional core, that movie.
Yeah.
I think that's why it works so well.
And it works so well as a double feature with the other film we saw.
Yeah, Shoplifters, surprisingly.
Weirdly enough, yeah. It actually works really well. They're both about the same thing to the core of the films. Mm.
I remember during Shazam, I read a review where someone compared Shazam to Shoplifters.
Really?
Yeah. Oh. And I was like, oh, maybe this double feature does make sense. Nice. We saw Shoplifters before Shazam.
Yeah.
And in a way, it's a bit weird going from a movie like that to Shazam.
But it, yeah.
Just filmmaking wise, because you're like, this, okay, it's a bit jarring.
Yeah.
But yeah, thematically, they're very similar.
Definitely. Yeah. Oh my God.
where it's about families and being able to choose your family.
Yeah. And just because.
Abandonment.
Yeah. And just because somebody who is in your family doesn't love you or treat you right doesn't mean they have to, you know, be the person that you look up to or the people. You know what I mean? Like you can choose to. Surround yourself with people who actually love you and care about you.
I guess not knowing where you're coming from.
Yeah.
In the way the Billy Batson character was kind of similar to the boy in
Shoto, is that what
in,
his name?
In Shoplifters, yeah.
Shoto.
I mean, he didn't shoplift. At the opening scene of Shazam, I was like, oh shit, is he shoplifting?
Yeah, same. I was like, I was whoa. Like, yeah, like so weird.
Some weird song was playing. I thought that. It was like an odd introduction to him at first because I'm like, what is he doing?
Let's go.
Like, why is he jumping into a police car?
Yeah. And I was like, because like when he was like, oh, the guy's in there. I was like, wait, what's happening? Like, and then he locks him in. I'm like, wait, what's happening? Like,
yeah.
Yeah. I thought he was going to steal the car.
I thought he stole something from the store and they were coming after him. And he's like, oh, the guy went that way.
And then he was going to like run. Yeah, same. And then he locked them in and I was like, okay, he's still in the car. And then I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah, he's looking for his mammy. Wendy Batson or whatever her name was.
Rachel Batson. The joke is that she's black, so she can't be his mom.
That's the joke at the start.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's not the payoff.
No, it's just funny.
We shouldn't spoil the payoff because this movie just came out.
It's funny because everybody in the front row like laughed way too hard at that.
Oh, people laughed way too hard at everything.
Yeah, they were like, Wah! I think it was just the people we were with, because those people in front of us were just like, oh my God.
I know, yeah.
They were talking throughout the whole movie.
Yeah, but this, someone next to them was like, can you guys stop talking, please?
And yeah. I was like, thank you. Yeah, because I was literally this close to, okay, pretend that this is their heads there. God, my finger. Scaring them. Like, yeah. They probably, yeah,
it's surprising how easy it is to get people to not talk in theaters though.
Yeah.
Because like I've had to do it before, like Cineplex, because Cineplex is fucking,
gang.
Full of, like teenagers, like going, I forget what movie I was seeing, but there was like teenagers like talking the whole time. I was just like, can you guys stop talking, please? And they stopped talking the whole movie.
Oh.
That's all you have to do.
Yes, all you gotta, you just gotta ask them to stop, yeah.
Yeah. Because they don't want to cause trouble, you know?
Unless they're psychos, and because when I went to go see A Quiet Place, somebody told someone to be quiet, and they literally had to get thrown out of the cinema. They were yelling and screaming.
Oh my God. Yeah, this is, some people are a bit fucking off their heads.
Yeah, just a bit. Anyway.
Shoplifters? Is that what we're talking about?
Yeah, Shoplifters. Shazam.
Shoplifters is beautiful. It's probably one of the best movies of last year.
Yeah, oh my God.
I added it
so
to my
beautiful list,
and it's like, I realize it's probably like my top five last year. Yeah.
So gorgeous.
It's so comforting and like a nice to watch, but at the same time, it's like heartbreaking.
Yeah. So
without
sad.
Spoilers.
So sad. Yeah.
There's like a bittersweet aura to the whole thing, but it gets to a point where it's like, oh.
Yeah.
It makes you reevaluate the whole movie.
Exactly. Yeah. There's like a point in the film when you kind of realize, like, oh. Like, I can kind of tell that this isn't going to end well. Like, even though it's, like, got some, like, beautiful moments and you just want it to finish right here so you'd, like, you know.
Yeah, I was surprised how, like, traditionally, like, structured and scripted it was.
Yeah.
Because I haven't seen much of Kore-eda's other films. I've seen, like, probably one or two.
Yeah.
But those other ones, they seem very, like, fly on the wall, observational.
Yeah.
Like, just slice of life type movies.
Which is so Japanese.
Yeah, but this one had like a, like it had turning points and a traditional like movie structure.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Just the way everything unfolded and there's mystery and
resolution.
Everything was set up really well.
Yeah.
You know? Well, I like Shazam. I liked Shazam wasn't as tight of a like screenplay as I thought it would be.
No, but definitely.
The third act really like paid off a lot of stuff in a nice way. A few good surprises as well.
Yeah.
Which is cool.
I like
not surprises you'd expect necessarily.
Yeah.
Like surprises where it's like, oh, I wouldn't have thought they'd do that.
You know? Shazam in cinemas now.
What else did I watch? Probably not much. Two TBH.
Little Italy.
I want to watch Little Italy. I watched Paddleton.
Oh, Paddleton. Yeah.
You laugh every time I say the title just because it sounds like Paddington or Patterson.
Yeah.
But it's, if you haven't heard of it, it's a movie on Netflix. It's a Netflix original produced by Mark Duplass.
Duplass.
He always does these Netflix originals these days.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it stars Mark Duplass and Ray Romano, and it's a cancer movie.
Hey, I'm Ray Romano.
Yeah, like these two guys that live like in the same apartment complex and they're like best pals. One of them gets diagnosed with cancer.
Bruh.
Mark Duplass. And it's kind of a different cancer movie to other ones in a sense. It's very simple and it's not like going to change your life with the filmmaking or anything, but like it's so effective.
Yeah.
Makes you cry. Makes you laugh.
Makes you cry.
I laughed a lot. Ray Romano is really funny in it. But it's different in the fact that he accepts like straight away that he's got the cancer and he's like, I just want to end it quick, you know.
I'm gonna end
and most of it's like them trying to like get prescription for this not pill, but it's like this
treatment
that like pretty much knocks you out in your sleep.
Oh,
so it's like a bit of, it's like a road trip movie of them going to get this thing,
like euthanasia basically.
Pretty much it's like these like tablets they all pour into like a water and drink it. And then
euthanizes you.
Pretty much, yeah.
That's sad.
And I won't share if they go through with it or not. But yeah, it's the ending's really
Wait, they both euthanize themselves.
No, Ray Romano is helping Mark Duplass.
Okay, I was going to say, like, that's a bit weird. Like,
yeah. There's lots of just funny stuff in it. Like, the Ray Romano is a bit conflicted about it, obviously. So he buys, like, a child's, like safe. Those child safes with, like, a key pin. And he puts it in there. And Mark Duplass is like, what's that? And he's like, well, what's what? Like, well, where's the pills? He's like, well, I don't know. It's just this child safe sitting there. It's like, what's the pin number? And he's like, pin number for what? Lots of like little situations like that.
Yeah. But, I love Ray Romano.
It's a nice movie.
Us.
Nice movie. Oh, yeah. We saw Us, didn't we?
Yes. We watched Us.
That was good.
I got five on it. Dun, 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 dun. The way I like to explain this movie, or like the experience of watching it, was that when it was good, it hit. It was like, oh, fucking yeah. Good. But when it wasn't, you could like see through it. I don't know. You know what I mean?
I guess so. It's,
yeah.
Logically, it doesn't hold up as well as Get Out does, but I don't think he was trying to.
No, definitely not.
Because like that whole, I guess this is spoilers, the whole reveal, I guess, of what's actually going on. If you like try and think of it on like a logical level, it's like, that doesn't quite make sense.
But yeah, no, it doesn't.
It's a metaphor. It's
metaphor. What do you think filmmaking-wise, though?
Filmmaking-wise is really good.
I agree.
Cinematography, the camera direction is really good. I noticed that a lot.
So good.
The way he blocked scenes and stuff.
It was like a dance, the way that like...
Oh, yeah, there's one sequence really cool. Pas de deux.
Pas de deux.
No, I liked it a lot. It's sitting better with me after like some thought. Cause
yeah, for sure.
When it ended, I was kind of like, huh.
Yeah.
Like I didn't get out of it what I was expecting to, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Because it kind of goes different directions that, you know. Because Jordan Peele's only made Get Out, so that's like the only frame of reference.
Yeah, and everyone's him as a filmmaker, so everyone's
expecting it to be Get Out again, but it's not.
Which is so annoying because it's like, why would you expect a filmmaker to make the same film twice?
Yeah.
Like, God.
And once again, it's another film where everything is really well set up. Like the first and last shot echo each other in a way you wouldn't expect.
Yes.
And there's twists and turns that make sense when you think about it. But at the time I was like, huh.
Mm.
You know?
Yeah.
Us.
I really want to see it again.
Yeah. I think I like it more a second time. But yeah, good premise. I liked when they had fun with it. I'm not a big fan of how Jordan Peele puts comedy in these movies. It feels unnatural.
Like how sometimes. They had like Fuck the Police playing while they were getting... Oh, wait. I don't know. I don't want to spoil that.
I guess that was...
Would you call that comedy or would you call that like... I don't know. Or do you mean the parts comedy, where he was like...
But that was more like...
Code switching. You know, that part in the train is like, if you want to fuck with me, then let's fuck. I don't know.
Yeah.
Like,
I guess, yeah.
But that's just like... I feel like... I don't know. Is that comedy or is that showing like how, like, you know, the upper middle class black American male will like go from like sophistication to...
Yeah, it wasn't that bit as much. It was more like in like the horrific scenes where they'd be like, ooh, we've been silly. I don't know.
Like the kids, they'd be like, oh, I killed this person. No, I killed this person.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't know what you're trying to
reference.
I
don't know specifically which bits, but
sorry, I
there were
too
bits
much.
Where I was like, you didn't need that.
Yeah.
You know, it makes you take the characters less serious because it's like, oh, if they don't care what's happening, then like, why do I care?
Yeah, true.
They're all just being silly.
Mm.
And yeah, that's Us. It's a good movie. Everyone's seen it by now, I guess.
Every single one.
Yep, especially Jordan Peele. Imagine if he hasn't seen it.
He'd like, have to. He's
it's like
director.
Josh Trank with Fantastic Four. He didn't see it till the premiere because they stole it from him.
Oh, my God. That's awful.
And we also watched Baywatch. Anyways, do you want to get into the comics of this week?
Yeah.
Unless I have other stuff to talk about.
Lost
Let me see.
It. There it is.
I noted some stuff down before. Joker trailer. It was all right.
Yeah, I'm excited for the Joker movie. It feels like something that I'll like. I don't know.
I'm skeptical. It could be this year's Venom.
Hey, like what's wrong with Venom?
Nothing's wrong with Venom.
Exactly.
That's why I'm excited for Joker.
Joker.
Also
it
just
feels
wanna,
like a movie. Sorry.
Sorry, you go.
I don't know. Right now, though, it feels like it's going to be a movie that, like, rise up gamers people are going to, like, revere.
Revere.
Mm.
Yeah, I can see that.
Mm. Anyway, continue.
No, I was just going to say, I want to just shout out this YouTube channel called Buff Cornell, who does these dance covers with his shirt off.
Oh, my God.
And he's been doing it for 3 years, I think we found out. 5 years. Yeah. And it's for all the, it's just, imagine this really buff guy with like his hair slicked back and he's wearing jeans and he's in
shirtless.
In a white room with all white walls.
And he has and one dresser.
We've got one dresser.
With like 10 lotions on him.
And his tripod set up facing the mirror. So you can see the tripod in the mirror.
And you can see him dancing in the mirror.
And it's him dancing in the mirror, but you can also see him in the corner of the frame dancing. And he's reading the lyrics off off camera.
And really and out of tune.
And he's got a poster of himself on his wall. And at first I was like, this got to be a joke. But when you find out he's been doing this for 5 years, every day, I think he takes it himself a bit serious.
Yep.
And that's why it's good. Mm. So go watch Buff Cornell on YouTube. His Tame Impala cover, especially, of... The less I know, the better.
Would you go to this? Sorry, I'm just interrupting the podcast, but...
Marvel Trivia.
Yeah, it's like Endgame Day, but it's at 5:45. It's free.
Oh, yeah, is that before when we see it?
That's after. No, after. Ages after.
Oh, yeah, we're seeing it in the morning.
Yeah.
Yeah?
We just need, like, 4 people to do trivia with, though, so we need two other people who are, like, know anything about Marvel, really.
We'll get Ruby.
Hello, Ruby. So if you want to join our trivia team...
email in.
Email in. No.
Get Thomas to fly out to Australia.
But yeah, anyway, I'll just tag you in that because I want to see. Because that would be fun, I think.
Yeah. I know Marvel stuff, I guess.
Mm.
What was that? Anyways, what's your comic this week?
My comic this week was issue.
Your issue.
Dirty suit.
Wow.
The Amazing Spider-Man, issue 53. Look who's back. I'm racist, sorry. Wait, hold on.
I'm chewing, that's why I'm not saying anything.
You burp.
Yeah, I'm sick. Not sick, but like
sick
my gold. Insides aren't cooperating.
Mm. Okay, so the Amazing Spider-Man enter Dr. Octopus. And we open
he's back.
With Spidey in like a, what do you call it? Like a web hammock. And he's got for some reason, they never explain why, but he's got like a backpack made out of webs on. Anyway, he's just chilling, reading the newspaper. And he's like, well, it figures. I did all the work. And Jolly Jonah writes the story as if he's the hero and I'm the heavy. You know, regular Spider-Man stuff. And J. Jonah Jameson's yelling at him from out the window. Like, come on, dude. And anyway, Spider-Man gets really mad at this. He's like, oh, geez. So he swings on into J. Jonah Jameson's office and throws a newspaper at his face. And then, you know, does a bit of quipping and then leaves. He's like, J. Jonah Jameson, you got to stop writing about me in your paper. I'm not a menace.
And as he does.
Like, you're a menace. You're a freak. I'll see you behind bars. Why is he so angry? Anyway. Spidey's sitting on the lip of a bell tower, clock tower, bell clock tower. Is that what they're called? Okay. He's like, sheesh. Huh?
What's he doing? He's meeting.
No, he's just sitting there.
He's sitting there.
Bell clock tower, just contemplating. He's saying, sheesh, one of these days that iron-lunged ignoramus is going to push me too far and I'll cool it. I'll grin and bear it, the same as always. And then all of a sudden, bong, the clock goes off and he gets... periodically deafened.
No, no.
Yeah, it's pretty sad. And it reminds him somehow that class is due soon.
So oh, because bells.
The bells, yeah.
Do universities have bells?
I don't know. Not here. They don't.
I guess his might.
Yeah, maybe.
It's like a campus.
Hmm. Do they have like, in America, do they run on like a daily schedule like high schools do? Like.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know.
Maybe, I don't know.
Yeah. Who knows? If you're from America, please tell us. Anyway, so he swings on by uni and he lands at college. And he's like, everyone's like, whoa, it's Spidey. And he's like, yeah, don't mind me, guys. And Gwen is with Flash and he seems to be back from wherever he was posted at the military. He's wearing his uniform and
back Gwen's again. Like,
tell me, true Soldier Boy, are you really Spider-Man's number one fan?
Oh, that's right. Flash is Soldier Boy.
Mm-hmm.
Yo.
And Flash is like, you can say that again, gorgeous. That Masked Marvel is one Joe I'll take my hat off to any day. And then the Captain America theme starts playing softly in the background.
I was going to go. But that's not him.
No, it's not. Anyway.
It's everyone's theme in the Avengers.
Yeah, technically, I guess.
Anyone can show up and that'll be their theme.
Korg and Meek. Anyway.
That'd be pretty good, actually.
Yeah.
Imagine if they showed up in Wakanda.
Valkyrie's alive. Anyway.
Oh, yeah.
I keep forgetting that. Okay.
There was a new Endgame trailer, but I didn't watch it.
Is she even on the poster?
She's not on the... Well, she's on, like, one of the international posters. Mm. She shared it. She's like, hey, look, I'm on one of the posters. Here's links.
And everyone's like, dot, dot, dot. No, I'm kidding.
Probably in a scene.
Yeah.
With Korg going like, hey, look at us. You know?
Be humble.
On the Commodore.
Sit down. Be humble. Didn't the Commodore get ganked?
No. The Commodore's the one they stole.
Yeah, but didn't it get ganked when they went back to the place?
Well, I know. It's on... It's like a smaller ship on the ship they were on.
Yeah, but didn't that ship explode?
Ragnarok. Yeah, but they... Valkyrie escaped.
Oh. Because
remember, everyone on that ship was dead.
Oh, except for Valkyrie.
But Valkyrie must have escaped off screen.
Hmm.
Because otherwise they would have showed her dead.
Hmm.
You know?
Okay. Well, Valkyrie's alive. what am I thinking about or talking about on the comic again? Gwen. So Gwen is talking to Flash. And they're talking about how much of a big fan Flash is of Spider-Man. And then Harry comes along. He's like, hey, has anyone seen Peter? I'm getting sick of being a social secretary. All I do is take messages for him because he's never around. And Flash is like, well, you know, he'll never change, Harry. And Gwen's like, I don't know where he is. And then we see Peter trying to find a place where he can change into Peter from Spider-Man discreetly.
Right.
I need a burp. I don't know why. Anyway, so he finds the roof of the gym and he goes in there and quickly changes, but he hears someone coming. So
that's gross, dude.
Yeah. So he starts climbing down like the gym ropes. You know, this is like from Captain Marvel, how she like climbs up those ropes.
The gym ropes from Captain Marvel.
Yep.
Not from gyms.
Not from Captain Marvel. Anyway. And his professor's like, why are you so sweaty, Peter? Like, what's going on?
Am I so sweaty?
And why Peter's are you like,
so sorry.
Tell me what to do. I don't know what to do.
I don't know what to do. Have we talked about that trailer in the podcast?
I don't want to. As a matter of fact,
I don't want to talk about that.
Tell me what to talk about. I don't want to talk about.
I'm not giving up on Eugene.
Look at what you made me do.
What did you make me do? I don't know what I got.
What was I saying? Oh, yeah. And his professor's like, what the hell? And then Peter's like, hey, I was just taking a little workout, sir. And then his professor's like, oh, I never realized you were so agile, son. Oh, you better tuck in your undershirt, though. And it's actually his Spidey suit.
Undershirt.
Okay, I'm leaving. You can do the podcast by yourself, Mike. I'm kidding.
You better be kidding.
Yeah. So it's actually his Spidey suit tucking out of his jocks. So he quickly tucks it in. And his professor's like, don't panic. No one's been exposed for a protruding undershirt. He's like, oh, phew. He couldn't tell. It had webs on it. Anyway, so he gets back to the swing of things. And the professor gives him tickets, two extra tickets to the science exposition, which he's like, thanks for that. Anyway, that's exactly what he said. Thanks for that. So Gwen is like, sees Peter Parker walking around. She says, "Say, aren't you the one who picked a peck of pickled peppers? What the fuck? Just say hello. Like, just say hello." Anyway.
That'd be boring. It would show she has no personality. It'd show she's a ditzy blonde.
Ditko blonde. Anyway, Pete's like, "Gwen, just the gal I'm looking for. Are you doing anything special tonight, pretty girl?" And she's like, "Everything I do is special, Mr. Parker." So then, and then Harry rocks up. He's like, "Hi, Pete. Flash said he'll look after you after class. Oh wait, look for you after class." Gwen, what? Oh no, he says, "Hello, Pete. Flash said he'll look for you after class, Gwen." So that was addressed to Gwen, not Pete. And Pete's just like, "What's with him? Why the big freeze?" And Gwen's just like, "Basically, you keep ghosting him and he doesn't like that. The fact that you live together and you're never home, like, annoys him." And anyway, Gwen's like, "So what did you have in mind tonight?" And Pete's like, "You know, the science expo. I've got two extra tickets if you want to come." And Gwen's like, "Oh my gosh, I thought you'd never ask, silly boy. In case you've forgotten, your little blonde buddy is this SCI major too." So she's basically really keen. And then sometime after class, Professor says to Pete, "So you're bringing Miss Stacy? I admire your choice, Parker." And then when they leave the building, Gwen and Pete see Flash and Harry. And Flash
and
tries.
Pete see Flash and Harry.
Flash tries to start a fight with Parker. Parker is having none of it. Even though they like to tussle, Gwen says, "No, boys, let's be civil." Do you like my song?
That was pretty all right.
All right.
I'll give you some pointers. Okay. Maybe add a little bit more doo-wop.
Doo-wop? What do you mean? Go.
More like scoop-bop, beebity-bop. You know?
Just that. Scoop-bop, beebity-bop-bow. One dum ba da ba dee da.
More boom. Ba-do-do-dum-ba-dum. Ba-dum. You know?
Boom. Ba-do-do-do-da-boom. This little heart of mine been broke a thousand times. Okay. Was that a song that's an actual song, or was that made up for the movie?
No, that's an actual song, isn't it?
Like, is it an actual old song, or did they just make it, write it for the movie?
It's a song.
This old it's gotta be. Heart of mine. I'm pretty sure they made it up for the movie.
What?
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking it up. Keep going.
Okay. I was like waiting. Anyway, yeah, so they try to, Flash tries to pick a fight, and he calls him civilian. He says, "Listen, civilian, are you trying to beat my time with Gwen?" Because he finds out they're having a date together. And Pete's like, "You never had any time to beat. And what's with the civilian bit? What were you before the draft?" And then Gwen butts and she's like, "At ease, man. Let's all meet later at Coffee Bean and puff a purple peach pipe." Oh, gosh, she's so weird. Anyway, Peach is like, "All right, whatever." And Flash is like, "Yeah, I'll flatten you when she's not around."
Oh.
And then Pete's like, "Let's go, Gwen." So they are heading off to the science symposium. And Harry shows up. He's like, "I can't explain it, but he acts like he's in his own private world and everyone else better keep out." And Flash is like, "Yeah, it's all right. He's a fucking idiot anyway, so why do you care?" Anyway, they're in Professor Warren's car on the way to the symposium. And Pete's like, "Hey, I wonder what they're featuring at the science exhibit today." And Gwen's like, "According to the paper, in a new type of missile defense called a nullifier." Yeah, they just have a little bit of small talk. They show up to the symposium and there's a demonstration of the nullifier's stabilizer control. And Gwen's just like, "Oh, somehow it all seems like the start of a James Bond movie."
Burnham, bum. Wait, now how's James Bond go? Is there another Bond movie this year?
No.
Oh, okay. When's the Danny Boyle one come out?
After the Beatles one. Yeah. Oh, yeah, it isn't.
It's by the Isley Brothers.
There you go. Okay, I was wrong. You proved me wrong.
For a second, I thought I was wrong, but I kept diving into the internet. Rubber Band Man, that's the Infinity War song.
Yeah, it is.
When the Guardians arrive.
Yeah. Oh, I love that.
I remember that bit. Everyone's like, because it's like space.
Yeah.
Yeah, and everyone's like,
space.
It's like in Civil War, it's like Queens, and everyone's like.
Everyone in the cinema stood up and clapped.
And Alt J is playing for some reason. Because teenagers these days, they love their Alt J. The classic vid.
Yeah, I love that vid. They're eating rice crackers, dude. Anyway.
Oh, nice.
I just have to get out of my system. Anyway, Pete's, yeah, so they're looking around the symposium, waiting for the demonstration to start. And Pete's just thinking, the most exciting part about being here is being with Gwen. How can anyone so beautiful also be so... Wait, my spider sense is starting to tingle. And Gwen's like, what's wrong, Pete? You look strange. You feel all right?
Oh, no.
And Pete's just whacking his head to and forth. He's trying to figure out what's wrong, why his spidey sense is going off. He's like, I don't see anything happening. And there are guards all over the place. I feel fine. I just thought I recognized someone, Gwen, he says. But he obviously looks really panicked. Gwen's like, oh, you must have seen a ghost. But then Professor's like, you know, let's be seated. It's fine. And Pete's thinking, there must be someone here to do something with the nullifier. I just can't slip away and become Spider-Man right now. There's too many people.
Can you see the nullifier, sir? Yeah. Can you see it in the pictures?
There.
Okay. Because I know the Fantastic Four have a nullifier that they use to defeat Galactus.
Galactus.
It's called something. It's like the something nullifier.
There you go. It'd
be like the cosmic nullifier.
Cosmic nullifier. It's actually the one from this issue.
Or David's nullifier or something.
David's nullifier. Okay.
Who's David?
David.
David Banner.
Eric Banner.
Oh. How do you reckon he'll feel about Ben Mendo being dead?
I don't want to find out, but we're going to have to eventually.
Yeah. Well, they were good mates.
Yeah.
We know that for a fact.
Oh, well.
We'll just have to lock the doors.
Yeah, lock.
Instead of just leaving them open and saying, Hollywood celebrities, please come in.
Big neon sign. Because as we know, Hollywood people love...
All Chris's stay in the basement.
And all Kristen's stay in the attic.
All the Chris's go to basement. Especially Hemsworth.
Oh, my gosh. I haven't taken that out in a while. I feel so good.
Somebody took out her glass eye.
Yeah, dude. It actually is so gross. Like, yeah. Anyway, I don't know how to do it right now, but it was
really
uncomfortable.
She just wanted to be like Mark Strong in Shazam.
Yeah, I wanted to be like Sans.
Mark Sans. Ghost door.
What is she doing? Anyway. Ruby. Okay.
If you guys don't know, Ruby's actually Sammy's subconscious.
Yeah.
She's a figure of her imagination. I just go with it.
No, she isn't. She lives in my subconscious and she is able to leave my subconscious, okay? She's not a figure of my imagination.
I was going to reference Legion, but you haven't watched it yet.
Well, there's another character Aubrey that's Plaza. Like that.
She's like Ben from Umbrella Academy.
Yeah, like that kind of. But like
he's a real person.
He's a real person. Yeah, he's separate. My person's more like a split came to life, like but as a separate entity. So like
banana split.
Yeah. Anyway.
Like in Lego Movie 2. Remember the banana?
This song's gonna get stuck inside you. This song's gonna get stuck inside you. This
you know,
song's
funny.
Gonna
that song
get
never
stuck
got stuck
inside,
inside my head.
Head.
I saw it twice.
This song's gonna get stuck inside you.
No,
this
what are you
song's
doing?
Gonna get stuck inside you.
This song's gonna get stuck inside your head. No, it didn't get stuck in my head.
That's like the perfect way to end that. But yeah, no, it didn't get stuck in my head.
It didn't.
Okay.
Did I say I saw it again? I probably said that last week.
Yeah.
It's good. Batman flosses. Batman flosses in Lego Movie and Shazam flosses in Shazam. I'm going to start a list. Movies where superheroes floss.
Bloss. Ow. Ow, 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 ow.
Floss dance, to be specific. He doesn't clean his teeth.
I mean, the
Zachary Levi has good
Batman
teeth.
Where he goes to marry her.
I just died on your arms tonight.
D-dish.
No, that's Lego Batman. It must have been something you said.
You should watch Lego Batman movie.
Yeah, Lego Batman movie too.
There's bits where he watches Jerry Maguire for some reason. It's like his favorite movie.
Isn't there a second Lego Batman movie?
No.
No, that's the game. Never mind.
Oh, why?
No, because at work, I always see Lego games. Like every day, I at least sell one Lego game. And like I always get them confused with the movies because I constantly am looking at Lego
games. They have fucking Lego Marvel, don't they? They have Lego. Like,
they have
everything.
Lego Jurassic World. They have Lego Marvel. They have Lego. Lego Movie, Lego.
That's weird. Lego Movie, the game.
Yeah, they do. They have so that. Silly. They have Lego Batman. They have
Indiana Jones.
Yeah, Lego Indiana Jones. Lego Harry Potter. Lego Star Wars. Yeah.
Mm.
There's a lot of them.
Lego Star Wars is the OG.
Yeah, the Yoda dying noise.
I can't do it.
Something like that. Anyway, what's happening in the world of comic books? Pete's trying to find out what's going wrong, and the demonstration starts, and the scientist is like, to begin our demonstration, we're now projecting a simulated missile attack upon the screen behind me. This is the first time these Defense Department films have been declassified for public viewing. And then someone stands up from the audience and says, and it will be the last time. What? Who said that? I did, the one only one on Earth powerful enough to seize your nullifier, despite anything you can do. And Pete's thinking, that voice, it could only belong to one man. And then all these tentacles, metal tentacles, appear from behind his cloak. It is Dr. Octopus. Stand and arise, you helpless, bumbling fools. No one can stem the matchless attack of Dr. Octopus. And he grabs a scientist and then... Tell me what to do. I don't know what to do. Anyway, he picks up the nullifier and the guy and he starts punching people and everyone's like, and running away.
Olivia Octavius.
Yes. Come here, little boy. That's what he says.
Oh my God.
Movie.
Is that Michael Jackson?
No. Oh my God. That's actually what she says in the movie. She's like, come here, little boy. And then she does that. No, blah.
I'm surprised there was like no fuss made over Olivia Octavius existing.
No, there wasn't.
Because you'd think someone would bitch about it.
But, no, it's because they made her kind of attractive in like a weird way.
She looked like one of the teachers from Harry Potter, dude.
Yeah, but
she looked like the biology, not biology, like the plants.
I look at too much Shad Base.
Oh. Okay, continue.
Never mind. Please cut that out. Anyway,
Olivia Octavius.
My friends call me Liv.
There's three, actually.
My enemies call me Doc Ock.
We had this thing, people were saying like, oh, her and Aunt May fucked because she calls her Liv.
Oh, it's Liv.
Yeah.
No, oh, yeah.
But there is precedent for that in the comics
because... Because Doc Ock and May...
Aunt May have been like a...
Well, that's... Actually, if you just hold on to the end of this issue.
Actually,
I can't do it Liv. Today. You know, that actually makes sense. I like that about Aunt May, actually, in the Into the Spider-Verse.
It's Liv, my former lover.
she actually says that.
And I was like, what?
I told you to take it outside, punk. Anyway. I feel like I quote that movie now.
Yeah, go from the start. No. That's not how it starts.
No, so it starts like... It's like doing the intro but without any of the music. Just like the like noises. Just like... Yeah. Anyway. I've been stuck on this page for the last like 8 minutes.
Oh, sorry.
So everyone's in a panic and Pete's like, I knew it, something's happening. And Gwen and the science teacher run away and Peter's like, I have to change into Spidey. So he goes into the gentleman's room.
Ooh.
And he changes into Spidey and these cops show up and and they start throwing tear gas at him. He's like, he's not wearing a mask, so tear gas will stop him. And then Doc Ock's like, you wish, because I can just swing my metal arms around like a helicopter and blow it away like a fan, idiot. I keep wanting to burp, but I feel sick. Anyway, so he blows away the tear gas and it gets into the guards' faces and they feel a bit oofed. And he grabs them all. He's like, I got you. And then all of a sudden you hear a voice from off the screen. You're living in your teeth, grapefruit head. I beat you before and I can do it again. It's only me, Doc, your friendly neighborhood Spider-Man. And he swings and he does a big kablammo, kicks him in the head, throws him across the room.
This be empty.
And they have a big old tussle and Doc Ock's trying to get him with the nullifier ray thing. And Spider-Man's doing quips. I really like the way that this issue's drawn. I feel like it's so appealing. Like, all, like, the poses and the colors. Like,
yeah.
I don't know. I just really like this, the way that this issue is visually. Like, I love, like, the layout of the panels in this issue specifically. It doesn't just feel like it's all messy. It feels like every panel was, like, thought out, like, shape-wise. And it all, like, you know.
It's good.
It's not all the same every single page.
You're done good.
Anyway. John so, yeah, they have a fight and they end up on the roof and everyone's watching. They're like, oh, my God, they're fighting on the roof. Kind of like in that movie, you know, that Sam Raimi movie?
Hmm? Which one?
I don't know. You know?
On the roof?
Not on the roof, on the building.
On the building?
You know how they're fighting on the building?
Wow.
Doc Ock's on the building and he's like...
Dum, dum,
and he's got
dum,
Aunt May.
Dum, dum. Oh, that bit.
Yeah.
Dun, 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 dun. Doc Ock's theme.
Yeah.
Best villain theme.
That what that was the fuck that was that noise. Anyway, meanwhile, among the many spellbound spectators on the ground, we find Gwen.
Why?
And the professor.
Oh.
And they're looking for Pete.
Ooh.
But talk about female intuition. Gorgeous Gwen just couldn't be brighter because she said, I can't help feeling that Pete's in danger. And she's looking away from Spider-Man while she's thinking that, which is
I'm being a soundboard.
You are actually. Yeah.
Oh. Ooh.
It's like that song by Billie Eilish, Wish You Were Gay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like watching Shazam with fucking stupid people.
Yeah, stupid people in the row in front of you.
He says like, I'm a disabled kid, I've got it all. And everyone's
like, yeah, they're all like, just like, do you think I'm your mama?
Dude, so I saw Deadpool in that exact same theater, and I'm convinced it was the same people.
Oh my God.
When I saw Deadpool the first time, people were literally cackling at everything.
The first Deadpool.
Yeah, the first Deadpool. Like, opening credits, everyone's like,
How did you get in the cinema? I thought it was an R movie.
What? No.
It wasn't?
Not here.
Okay.
It's MA15, dude.
Okay, maybe I'm wrong. Don't worry about it. It's probably a dream I had.
Wait, how old were we when that came out?
16?
Deadpool, no. We were in uni when that came out.
That's a bra moment, really?
Yeah. 2016, yeah.
I swear I was tiny. I was in high school.
No, we were definitely in uni.
Oh, the trailer, the first trailer, or the first like scene came out when we were in high school.
Because I was already living in Brisbane.
Brisbane. I have such a bad memory. Anyway. It's all the Coke I drink. Coca-Cola, I mean. Anyway, so Spider-Man thwips Doc Ock in the face. And he says, you figured have the advantage here on the roof because you could stand on your feet and use all your forearms for fighting. Well, you can't hit what you can't see. And he's got him and Doc Ock's like, I can't see. Doc Ock is got the nullifier. Okay, it's kind of hard to decipher what's happening here, but here we go. So Doc Ock has the nullifier. His eyes are covered, so he can't see what's happening, but he's got it hanging over the street with a whole bunch of spectators on the street below, and he's threatening to drop it if, Spidey doesn't basically, like, give up the fight. And Spidey's like, I can't let those people die, but I need to make sure I know where Doc Ock is. So he throws his tracer on him, and then Doc Ooh. Ock throws the thing, and he goes to chase after it, and he quickly catches the nullifier before it hits all these people on the pathway, which would be horrific. Think about that. Think about the injuries that would sustain from that. Oh, that's horrible. Anyway, so meanwhile on the rooftop, Doc Ock's like, it's no use. I can't get the fluid off. But I can't remain here like this. I'm too vulnerable. I can use my tentacles as feelers and I can still make my way till safety. So he runs away. And Pete's like, sorry.
Oh, no.
I feel like I'm getting sick. Anyway.
Peter always gets sick.
That's what he says. No, it's not. It's what I was saying.
Oh.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
Oh. Anyway, so Pete's like,
ooh.
Hey, guys, can you hang on to this gizmo for me? You don't find any valuable nullifiers on every street corner.
Dude, Spider-Man's got gadgets and gizmos aplenty.
He's got who's-its and what's-its galore.
Thingamabobs? He's got 20. Who cares? It's no big deal.
I want more. What will I let the people know? Okay. All right.
I was just explaining the Peter Parker
character.
So
he goes back to the roof. And Doc Ock's not there. And he's like, well, right now I'd better change and cut back to Gwen and the professor. And then I'll have to do some explaining as usual. And since Modesty impels us to turn away while Spidey changes into his clothes once more, let's return to the fiendishly fleeing Doc Ock. And Doc Ock is fleeing. And he gets to his lab. Oh, he's going to his lab. And he has a flashback to that time he battled Spider-Man in... the issue of Spidey 33. Do you remember that, guys? When he got trapped under that thing and the water was filling up and he had to use all his strength to lift it up, like in Spider-Man Homecoming.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Like in...
Anyway, so he flashes back to that and he basically just explains how he was able to escape because he had his oxygen tank and stuff. But anyway, he is back in his lab and he realizes that the trace is on him. And he's like, grr, the trace is on me. Well, I'm going to play a prank on Spider-Man. What a guy. And Gwen, we're back to table. Sorry. I'll just read this a little bit. And speaking of table turning, who'd ever suspect that the weary-looking youth approaching Professor Warren
is a DJ.
The world's most famous web-slinger just seconds before... Yeah, he's a DJ, dude.
Turntable.
Oh. I don't know how to do that thing. Okay, you're not going to do it.
All right. That's how you do it. Someone said that it's together.
Anyway, so Gwen is getting really worried. She's like, if we don't find Peter soon, perhaps we should. But it's like... But the professor's like, it's all right, Gwen. I see him. He's coming this way now. And Peter's approaching. He's thinking, all right, I'm going to win another Academy Award from
another
this
one
from this performance.
Oh, whoa.
Fucking
no. Oh, they didn't spell it right.
Okay.
You're like peanut M&Ms.
Basically, Pete's like, I'm going to have to make up an excuse and I'm going to win an Academy Award like I usually do. And he shows up and it's actually really adorable. Look at this panel. Gwen is so happy to see Pete and she just hugs him. He's like, I'm so glad you're okay. And Pete's like, as soon as I saw what was happening, I ran out to find a camera. If only I could have found one. And then he's like, Gwen's like, it doesn't matter where you were, Pete, as long as you're back. I never realized you were so habit-forming, man-child-like, being hooked on pistachio nuts.
What?
Yeah, read that. How does that make... I don't even know.
I never realized you were such... What? I didn't even say... I never realized you were so habit-forming, man-child-like, being hooked on pistachio nuts.
What does that mean?
Sounds like a lyric. I never realized you were so habit-forming, man-child-like, being hooked on pistachio nuts.
I don't understand what that means. Can someone decipher that for us? Anyway, Pete's just thinking, man, I actually really like this girl. She's the only one who's never asked me for any explanations. And they're back in the car with the professor, and he drops them off at the coffee place. And he's like... care to join us for some coffee, sir? This is Pete. But Professor's like, no, sorry, I don't hang out with alumni. I mean, not alumni, it's students. He doesn't actually say that, but he's like, thanks, but no thanks.
Oh.
And then they go into the coffee bean. Guess who's there? Flash. Harry. MJ.
Oh.
Yeah, MJ's
there. What are they doing?
And yeah, so Gwen walks in and she announces the Parker fan club is now in session.
Ooh.
And MJ says hi. And Flash is like, say, Gwen, you're still with Peony Parker. How about leveling? Did you lose a bet or something? And Gwen's like, face it, friends. You've got your guru. I've got mine. And Harry's literally not saying anything. He's just death staring Pete. Look at him. Look at this guy.
He's like Scott Pilgrim.
Yeah.
Where he's death staring. It's the drummer. Where it's like, what's her name? Allison? No.
Oh, yeah. The drummer, the redhead lady. Yeah, I know who you're talking about.
What happens, but it cuts to her and she's like.
Yeah. Yeah, she like death stares. I love that movie. Anyway.
Someone said you like Scott Pilgrim. I also like Scott Pilgrim.
Needs more doo-wop.
Bring my star.
Okay, stop. All right, let me continue. I'm nearly done, okay?
Thank you.
All right. So they have a little catch up, and guess who shows up?
Jack.
Anna Watson.
Oh, I was wrong.
Anna Watson and May Parker.
What?
And they're all smiles. Something must be up, says Pete.
I don't like that Peter has so many friends.
Yeah. Why? I like it.
I like it.
It's wholesome. They're meeting up at the coffee shop and they're all having fun.
I like in Spider-Man 2 where he has his birthday party is Mary Jane, Harry, and Aunt May.
That's awful.
That's the surprise party they threw for him.
Oh my god. He that's actually so depressing.
Harry and MJ pop out from the darkness and go, surprise. It's the friends you see every week.
It's so pathetic. It's the friends you see every week. I love that.
Actually, I think it's implied they haven't seen each other in a while on that one.
Yeah. Anyway, that's what depression like, does to you.
How's the bug these days?
I know how that feels.
How's the bug these days? How's the bug these days?
What? Have fun with those levels, dude.
Kill that guy.
Kill that guy. Anyway, can I please continue? Shush.
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to do it regardless whether you want to hear it or not. Anyway, so May's like...
I have no power anymore.
Peter, dear, I thought I saw you walk in here. And Anna's like, May couldn't wait to tell you the news. We placed an ad in today's newspaper. We thought of the most delightful way to make some extra pin money. And then it's a little ad that in the newspaper that says, room for rent, comfortably furnished, light and pleasant, suitable for a tired lady or gentleman, cool after 5 p.m. weekdays. And basically they're going to board out their room because, you know, they need the money and it's empty. Oh. And Pete's just like, oh, that's a great idea. And everyone's like, yeah, that's cool. And then Pete's like, see you later, group. I'll make sure no one flirts with these two pussy willows on their way home.
Oh.
They say it. Anyway, Harry finally says something. He says, no skin off my nose. Now we don't have one fella too many. What an asshole.
Ooh. Golly gee.
Anyway.
When does he become the Green Goblin?
Yeah, I wonder. But before our little saga turns into a singing soap opera, let's see what's shaken in the diabolical digs of the dastardly Doc Ock. Fortunately... this is Doc Ock speaking. Fortunately, I was one of the world's most competent atomic scientists before I turned my Titanic's talents to the cause of the total villainy. Thus, it is mere child's play for me to find a way to employ Spider-Man's electronic tracer against him. Yeah, so basically Doc Ock's setting a trap for Spider-Man. He leaves the tracer in there and he leaves. And before the night gets very much older, we see our boy Spider-Man swinging around the city. And he's like, you know what? I'm feeling free as a bird, but I've got to crisscross the city for a while until I... Wait, I'm beginning to sense something already. It must be these impulses... Sorry, there's no mistaking it. These impulses are coming from that waterfront shack. I'll crash right in and... No, now my body sense is tingling. It's warning me of something. The closer I get, the more it tingles. And basically he's swung over and he's on the roof and he's peeking in. He's like, I think this is going to be a trap, but I'm going to double check. And he looks and it's like, actually doesn't look like a trap. Just looks like Doc Ock at a panel of like machinery. Just, you know, but I won't buy it. My spidey sense is tingling. And he looks a little bit closer and he actually can see that his tracer bug is there. And he's like, well, you know, it hasn't learned how to crawl. So it should be on him, not the thing. So.
Oh, not the thing. Ben Grimm.
Yep. Ben Grimm is there. No, he's not. Anyway, he's like, I'll take a few precautions and I'll throw like a web ball in there and see what happens, because it could be a mine, it could be a trap. Let's see. Geronimo! And he swings his web ball in and look at what happens. The whole freaking thing explodes just from throwing it in there. Like a huge explosion. And I'm at loss for words. That's really diabolical. Anyway, there's a little note in the bottom right of this panel, which is really cool. It's like, special note for do-it-yourself buffs. We've generously left enough space for you to add your own impassioned sound effect. Resounding p-tow or a rock rollicking batoom might well fill the bill. Stereophonic Stan. Meanwhile, within the safety of his real hideout, Doc Ock fiendishly gloats, albeit prematurely.
What's his real hideout?
It doesn't say. Oh. He's just in...
The waterfront.
Yeah, maybe. He can see everything happening, so it has to be. I've destroyed Spider-Man, finally, and beyond doubt. How can he tell that's beyond doubt? Like, anybody could have walked in there and set that off. Anyway. But now, I've got to find a safer holding place. And then he packs up everything, and he's in disguise, and tries to lay low for a while.
Lay low.
And we see Spider-Man running, and he's like, I can't believe I'd be dead if it wasn't for my Spidey sense. And he goes, wherever Doc Ock is, sooner or later, I'll find him. A little teaser to the next issue where him and Spidey will meet, but not the way he expects. And it's Aunt May opening the door, and guess who answers the ad?
Jack.
Doc Jack.
What? Oh.
Yes, someone's at the door and it is Doc Ock. Anyway.
It's Alfred Molina.
Molina. Anyway, that was my issue. I really liked that issue this week, actually. I enjoyed reading it. It was entertaining.
I followed some of it.
Yeah, well, obviously, huh? Yeah, I'm not all of it. It's just some of it.
I followed some of it.
Yeah.
I liked the bit where Doc Ock was like, oi, I'm setting traps. Bub-ka-chow. And I liked when Flash was like, hey, Puny Parker, you suck. And J. Jameson's like, get me good picks.
Yay.
Mm-hmm.
Litty.
Yanny or Laurel?
Yanny.
Is this podcast insufferable? Yanny. Let us know.
I like recording it, so.
We like recording it, but do people like listening?
That's questionable.
Comment below. What's that? Oh, John Wick 3.
Here's another dog.
Is it the same one from the second one?
Yeah.
I hope so. I like that one.
Mm.
Okay, so I read an annual this week, so strap in. It's a long one. It's 50 pages. Would you believe it?
How long does this podcast go for already?
Check.
I have to get
into it.
All right, go.
So this one's called The Web and the Flame. Because if you can't put it together, it's Spider-Man and the Humane Torch.
The Humane Torch.
Yeah. And Spidey's swinging around, and it says at the bottom, mystery lovers, we've got a goofy new treat for you. All we're telling is that our Litten leader, Stan the Man Lee, scripted this yarn. Mickey DeMio did the inking. And adorable Jerry Feldman did the lovable lettering. But we're keeping the penciler's identity a secret. So,
mysterious.
For some reason, they're keeping the artist a secret for this one. The penciler. Sorry, there's multiple artists involved in a comic book.
Sorry, I'm messing with the thing.
Dude, stop fiddling with Ben Grimm over there, dude.
That sounds awful.
I mean, you're messing with the thing.
Yeah.
You get the ring ding.
You get the ring a ding ding.
Here's the rundown. Flashed. What's he called? The Humane Torch. He's running amok in the city. And Spider-Man's like, why is he going sicko mode? He's going too sicko mode for his own good. He's being a menace to the citizens. So Spider-Man pretty much swings in. He's like, wait, stop doing this. And they get into a bit of a little rough tussle. And Spider-Man shoots his asbestos webs at him. And then the Flash... fuck, why do I keep calling the Flash? The Humane Torch. They're too high up, so Humane Torch makes a little fire blanket for him to slowly make Spider-Man fall to the ground or something. Then Spider-Man opens a fire hydrant and douses
Humane Torch.
No.
While he's in midair. And then Human Torch is like, what the hell are you doing? Stop it. And then we find out someone comes in and says, hold it, hold it. And you find out it's a movie set. Human Torch was filming a movie and Spider-Man just fucking ruined
that
it.
That sounds like another movie. What movie does that? I feel like it's a trope.
Yeah, that's happened before.
Mm.
I mean, it's happened in Spider-Man comics before.
Yeah, it actually has.
He stopped at a rubber and they're like, oh, we were just filming a movie. And like, oh, jeez.
Oh, jeez, Rick.
I'm sorry. Do you reckon Stanley genuinely forgets like the stories he's written and just writes them again? He's like, oh, I've got a great idea.
Definitely.
But anyways, the director gives Spidey a talking to. Spider-Man's like, oh, fuck, I better leave. I've done a fool of myself. Back at the Bugle, Jameson's looking at pics and he's like, wow, these pics are good. How great is that? Then we see a mystery man walking down the street. And he's heard that Human Torch is filming a movie and that the web slinger almost ruined everything. And it gives him an idea. Then back at the Parker residence, Spider-Man hears on the radio that some production company announced that they're making a new film starring Spider-Man and the Human Torch.
Wow.
And Peter's like, ooh, this is great. I'm flying to Hollywood. And in like 90s movie fashion, you see him get on like an airplane and it's like,
let's go.
And he's like arriving in Hollywood and you see all the people in costumes and like the film sets and stuff. And he arrives in a Spider-Man costume, obviously, because he doesn't want to reveal his identity. And they're like, how can you prove you're the real Spider-Man? He's like, I could swing around for you or something, or jump across the rooftops. And he's like, I'll take your word for it, pal. And Spider-Man goes in and he's like, I don't have an appointment, but they're expecting me because I'm the star of the show, you know. And we see the mystery man again, see Spider-Man enter the office and he's like, good, he's fallen for my bait just as I had planned. And there's another mystery man and he's like, how did it go? Did he suspect anything? And he's like, no, another thing. This will be our greatest triumph. Before we are done, we will have brought to the destruction of both the web spinner and the Human Torch.
Bruh.
So there's these two mystery dudes trying to take down Spider-Man and the Human Torch just because they're the heroes, they're the villains.
And that's what they do, yep. Frankly enough.
Spider-Man wake up, he swings past people, and he bumps in the Human Torch, and they pretty much like come to a little bit of a truce. Because Human Torch is like, hey, we're going to be working on a movie together, we may as well, you know, try and get along, you know?
Mm.
And Spider-Man's like, all right, we'll do a truce. And Human Torch is like, just make sure that my name's bigger than yours in the poster, you know, or something like that.
Wow.
It's like, make sure I get paid the big bucks. And Spider-Man's like, yeah, fine.
The big bucks.
And yep, they arrive on set. They're getting their makeup done. There's like scroll looking dudes and makeup on the set. There's all these lights.
Scrolls.
Like, just like a movie. Oh, they're not scrolls, but like there's fake aliens.
Oh, okay.
In the movie. Yeah. And then they're getting in position and pretty much Spider-Man's reading the script. And he's like, oh, this sounds stupid, but I'll just go with it because it's good money. Because, like, Spider-Man's saving the civilians, like, down below, and Human Torch is, like, doing the heroic stuff.
Mm-hmm.
From, like, an alien invasion. And so, like, they're filming it. And, yeah, they get a good take. The director's like, that was an awesome first take. Good job. We'll do a second take from a different camera angle soon. Imagine getting it in one angle and one take. And being like,
that is a dream. That's the real fantasy here, is like getting a shot in one go. Yeah.
I don't think Stanley's been on a movie set. He thinks he's making it up.
That's why he was on so many of the Marvel sets as cameos. He's like, I want to know about this movie thing. It's saying this movie thing. I want to know about this.
Anyways, Human Torch is saying like, well, I never knew acting was so easy. I'm a natural. But Spider-Man suspects there's something up. His head's doing the thing.
Oh, the Spidey tingles.
Yeah, yeah.
Wait, can I see that art?
Yes.
Hmm.
It's a little bit different, isn't it?
A little bit.
So he swoops around. They're doing a second take. And Spider-Man still feels there's something up. And what do you know? The Human Torch is coming straight for him. So he's like, I don't have time to move out of the way. Oh, geez. And he almost gets swooped by a human torch.
No.
And they get into a bit of a tussle. Spider-Man throws like one of those big light reflection boards at him and smashes it over his head.
Wow. A flecky, as we call them in Australia. A flecky.
Yeah, I think that's what it is, at least. It like shatters. And they get into a bit of a fight, and Spider-Man's like, what's going on? And he loses track of Human Torch, sorry.
Mm.
And so he's like, I'll go to his dressing room. Maybe he's chilling out there. And the Human Torch is like, perfect. So far, everything's going exactly according to plan. And Spider-Man goes into the dressing room, and Human Torch is also in the dressing room.
What?
And he's what? Like, what? Spider-Man, what are you doing? And Spider-Man rips open the dressing room, by the way. He doesn't just open the door or kick down the door. He tears the fucking wall off.
What an asshole. And Human Torch That's is like, I'm so
just,
rude.
I'm just learning my lines in between the takes. What are you doing? And then we see the Human Torch that lured him in there talking to Mysterio. And he's like, I told you they would suspect nothing. Mysterio's like, good, good. I've waited too long for my revenge for anything to spoil it now.
Wait, what is going on?
And then we see there's a guy with like a flame suit.
Excuse me? How does that work?
Apparently just to be Human Torch, all you need is...
Just be covered in flames.
Yeah, just
even if your voice sounds completely different, you're like a different height.
Yeah, wear a flame-proof suit and anti-grav discs on your feet. That's what it says. To fly.
That's
60s science.
60s science.
They had all these things.
Mm.
And the dude's getting undressed and he's like, your talents have been great help in improving my suit. And Mysterio's like, yeah, that's what I do. I'm a special effects man. I can do all the good shit. Then we see this dude, his motivation. He just reads in the newspaper about the Human Torch and Spider-Man. He's like, I don't like them. So he teams up with Mysterio. Mysterio comes to him on a dark and stormy night. He's like, oi, help me out, you're Wizard. And I'm pretty sure he's just called Wizard. That's his name.
Just Wizard, that's it. Are you sure his name's Wizard. Not Shazam?
No, it's Wizard.
Shazam stands for?
The Wisdom of Solomon. The
Strength of Hercules.
The
Knowledge of Atlas.
The Power of Zeus.
Yeah, the lightning stuff.
The heel of Achilles.
The speed of Mercury.
Yeah. One or two of those is wrong, but you get
the last two are wrong, but yeah.
The speed of Mercury is right.
Oh, yeah, sorry. The heel of Achilles is right.
Yep. So the last two are right.
Yeah.
Anyways, we see the Wizard and Mysterio coming up with their plan. There's zappy lasers and gizmos and stupid shit. I don't know. I don't know how they make all these things. It doesn't make any sense.
Got him.
Then we cut back to Spider-Man trying to punch Human Torch. And Human Torch is like, what are you doing? Stop hurting me. And
stop hurting
me. He says, boy, you're really gone, kiddo.
Boy, you're really gone, did it.
Okay, this is what you want. It's all yours. And he starts throwing fire at him. Spider-Man's like, oh, shit. And they start fighting. And Spider-Man finds an asbestos tarp.
What?
And throws it on
him. The 60s was weird, too.
And it douses the flames. But as he falls, the tarp goes off him. So he can fly and be flamed on again.
Flame on.
So, you know, it was a temporary fix.
Wait, does he have to say flame on to flame on?
He doesn't have to, but he says it sometimes.
Mm.
And we see the Wizard and Mysterio watching, like, on security cameras, all this happening. They're like, what's wrong with them? Neither of them are exerting their power to their fullest potential. They should have totally annihilated each other by now. And he's like, hold it, Wizard. Don't pull that lever just yet. Give them a little more time. After all, we're in no hurry, and I'm enjoying the show. I've never fully realized how fast they were before or how powerful. And they're going sicko mode at each other, but even though Mysterio said that, he tells him to activate the ray, like, seconds later. He's like, oh, just leave it. I'm having fun. Activate and pull the lever.
Like, this is good. Kill them.
Kill that guy.
Kill that guy. I was like, me. You know what that's like? That's like my brain when I'm having a good moment, like self-destructive tendency. Like, I like this. Destroy it.
Pretty much. But yeah, a laser gets shot at them. And they're like, what was that? Oh, someone must be trying to kill us. So they team up.
What was that? Oh, someone must be trying to kill us.
Pretty much. I'm skimming through it. and there's this weird like ring of gas.
I fell into a burning ring of gas.
And Human Torch is like, ah, the gas is dousing me. It's getting rid of my powers. And Spider-Man's like, hold on, buddy, I got it. And he starts webbing up like the little vents on the ring.
Swip.
Like that.
Yep.
What if it made that noise?
Ew. Yuck.
Disgusting. Like in the first Spider-Man movie where he's like, Shazam.
And he turns into Captain Marvel.
Go. Go, Web, go.
Go, Web, go.
Anyways. he stops all the gases, the greenhouse gases, and Human Torch is like, yes, I can fly again.
Yes.
He's like, sock.
Yes.
He's flying again, and the wizard's like, oh, shit, they're onto us. We can't afford any more slip-ups. It's time for stealth, for secrecy is... Oh, the time for stealth and secrecy is past. We must attack and destroy. Mysterio says, it's time for you to shut up. and let me do the thinking for a bit.
That's mean.
And Spider-Man and Human Torch suspect where they are. And Human Torch like heats up the little room and they're like, oh, why is it getting hot? Oh no.
That's sad.
He's beginning to get like a furnace. And then Spidey and Human Torch come in and what? It turns out there were projections.
Oh, here we go.
Which doesn't make any sense because while they're going, oh, it's getting hot in here. They were fake. Unless they're trying to dupe them, but I don't think they could hear that.
No.
Anyways, we see the real wizard and Mysterio escape somewhere. And they're like, haha, I knew those images of yours would come in handy sometime, Mysterio. And he's like, haha, that's just a small part of my arsenal of magical special effects. So I now regret that I didn't prepare many more. Cool. I don't know why in special effects you'd learn how to make projections of yourself.
You know what? Sometimes you just need to, all right? So just don't question it, all right?
Holograms. Literal holograms.
Did they do that with Michael Jackson back in the day? Like, after he died, they were like, let's make a hologram.
They did that with Tupac.
Tupac?
I remember they did that with Tupac.
Tupac?
You like Tupac?
Yeah, he's all right.
And the Spider-Man, Human Torch... find the wizard and Mysterio on like a flying thing and they're flying away and they're like, haha, I knew they'd I knew they'd see us if we hovered here long enough, but we can't stay any longer. They'll be after us in seconds. Let's reach max speed and get out of here. So Human Torch and Spider-Man follow them, but then a giant mechanical gorilla that's like 20 feet tall starts attacking them. It's a robot gorilla, but it doesn't look like a robot. It just looks like a big, dumb, Bigfoot-looking thing.
That? What? Okay.
So they fight that. It knocks out Human Torch real good. But Spidey finds the panels on the back and like starts pressing shit. And Mysterio's like, oh no, Spider-Man was too fast for it. He's deactivated the gorilla.
He's deactivated the gorilla.
But we still achieved... It just really sounds like an issue they made up, like, as they were going.
That sounds fun.
But, yes. The wizard's like, we still achieved our objective. He'll never be able to free the torch from his vice-like grip. Then the next page, Spider-Man releases Human Torch from his vice-like grip.
Wow.
With no text, though, because Stanley's like, you know what? Sometimes stories can be told just with pictures. It's not what he says word for word, but this is what he says. Sometimes a page is drawn, which just doesn't need to... Just exist. Doesn't seem to need any words. So actually, it's pretty close to what I said.
Yeah.
In fact, we feel that a lot of dialogue, captions, and sound effects might actually detract from the sheer stark drama of the illustrations. This powerfully drawn page is a perfect case in point, enough said.
It's like that part...
That's still too many words for what he could have said.
Which is ironic, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
It's like that part in The Last Jedi.
Which part?
You know the part where there's no noise?
Yeah.
That's the part where they blow up the thing and then there's no noise.
They blow up Ben Grimm. Dude, imagine Fantastic Four movie, Chris Pratt as Mr. Fantastic. Dave Bautista as The Thing. Zoe Saldana as Invisible Woman.
Oh my gosh.
And Bradley Cooper as the Human Torch.
I love this. Can we make this happen?
Directed by James Gandolfini. Not James Gunn.
They not only play the Guardians of the Galaxy, but they are also...
They could bring Bradley Cooper in. You haven't seen him in the MCU. Yeah.
True.
Same as Zoe Saldana. We haven't seen her out of green face.
Yeah. Or Drax.
And Drax. I mean... Yeah. It'd just be Chris Pratt. Just shave him. Shave him bald.
Just shave him. Ew.
I'm just imagining a hairless Chris Pratt.
That's disgusting.
Like a sack of meat.
Wait, then that means Nebula would have to play Victor.
The victim.
The Victor Doom.
Oh, no, I've moved my mic too low. Now I have to...
Victor Von Doom.
It's going to fall.
Okay, that's a Shazam moment.
Now I have to burp. You gave me your burp powers.
Yay.
Anyways, what time are we at? Okay. Anyways, Human Torch and Spider-Man figure out where Mysterio and shit are. But they're like, perfect. We wanted them to find us. And they trap them and start launching fucking boulders at them somehow. Like mini meteorites.
Ooh.
They're like, oh, this sucks. And Human Torch does something with his heat. I think he bursts a hole in the wall. And Spider-Man does something with webs. Or he pulls, like, the levers. And the levers make the rocks fly outwards towards Mysterio and the wizard.
What is this issue? What is going on?
They're making it up on the spot, I tell you.
It's crazy. And
Spidey webs up the dudes. Human Torch burns their weapons. And they put them in a web sack for the police. The media is like... Spider-Man, why don't you and Human Torch team up, like, for realsies, you know, become a little duo? Spider-Man's like, nah, that's all good. Last thing I need right now is a partner. And he swings off. And Human Torch is like, hey, Spidey, I want to give you a share of the reward for our nabbing of those two clowns. And Spider-Man's like, a reward?
Ooh, an award?
You know something, Hothead? I think you're beginning to grow on me. Then the last panel is Peter asleep on the airplane on the way back home. From Aww. Hollywood. And the flight attendant is like, he must have had too much sightseeing in Hollywood. I guess he's the type that tires easily. Then it says, we don't know about Pete, but after writing 41 pages, we're kind of bushed ourselves. Enough said, the end. Then there's extra pages at the end where it's like Flash and the gang at a bar. And they're like, hey, Flash, you're a cool guy. I think that's the issue, like, at the end of your one you read.
Yes, yeah. Definitely.
Then we see these extra pages about how Spider-Man's stuff works, how his web shooters work. Double tap to twip and then release, or whatever it is. Then we see how strong Spider-Man is. We see Spider-Man's favorite foes, the lovable Lizard, Kraven the Hunter, the Green Goblin, Darling Doc Ock, the Sinister Sandman, the Rampaging Rhino, Ever-Loving Electro, the new Vulture.
Ever-Loving Electro, I love that.
Then we see a room tour of Peter Parker's apartment. Yep, cool. Done.
Enough said.
I did that pretty quick, considering it's 50 pages.
Yeah, I mean, it was a bit of a wacky one, to be honest.
Yeah. There was not really a plot. It was just... The plot was that they... This was Green Goblin's plan in the first Green Goblin issue, remember? He was like, I'm going to pretend to make a movie. So, but it's just an excuse for me to get people to beat up Spider-Man, remember?
Yes.
They're like, we're going to practice a scene over here, Spider-Man, if you want to join. He's like, oh yeah, cool. And they just beat him up.
They just literally beat the guy
That's
up.
What this was, but 10 times more elaborate and stupid.
Nice.
So I think that was the worst annual so far. Because the first one was Sinister Six. That was fine.
That was fine, yeah.
Second one was Doctor Strange and Spider-Man. That was my favorite one. And then the third one was like, the Avengers told him to stop the Hulk. Was that it?
Yeah.
That was the one you read.
I like that one the best.
Yeah.
The Hulk
Maybe if I read
Avengers
it, I'd like
one.
That one.
Yeah, that one was fun.
But anyways, that's...
Yes,
that's the end of the pod.
The pod came.
How good is that?
That was pretty good.
Yeah. Any last thoughts? Any more beliefs?
Beliefs. I really like the issue I read. I'm actually really excited for the next one to continue
Doc
from
Ock.
It. The Doc Ock and May relationship.
Yeah.
It's going to be fun. Yes.
I like you.
I like to move it.
That's what they say.
All right, everyone. See you on the flip side.
No, if you want to follow us at Peter Palmer Pod on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, Gmail. You don't follow us on Gmail, but you can email us on Gmail.
Yeah, they cancelled that.
Yeah. G Plus. Yeah, Google Plus. Yeah, just let us know anything. Let us know if this is a bad podcast. Let us know if it's a good podcast. But don't let us know if it's a mediocre podcast. We don't want that meddling shit, you know.
Oofed. He's swory.
But anyways, who's this? Hang on.
Oh no, here we go.
Hey guys. It's been a while since I've been here.
Oh, Eric. Oh, come on. We locked the door this time. How'd you get in?
Oh, you guys gave me a key.
Oh. Did you do that, Mike?
Yeah. I trusted them, you know, but after the...
why this has all happened.
I mean, yeah, nothing happened.
Nothing happened, yeah. Sorry, never mind.
Oh,
okay.
So that's good that nothing happened. Thank you for reassuring me because I'm a bit worried about Mendo. I haven't seen him in a week. Last time we spoke, he said he was coming here.
Oh,
okay. Check on Hemsworth.
I don't know. Don't know anything about it. No. It's okay.
Did you guys see him when...
It's actually getting really late. I'm actually really tired.
Did you guys see him when he was here, though?
No,
we didn't.
No.
Oh, okay.
Do you want a cup of tea or something?
It's okay.
Don't cry, man.
My friend Mendo. I'm worried about him.
I can't. I need to go.
See you next week. Yeah. Bye.